I'm the reviewer. You review it, I review you. This is my partner, Mr. It. Well, with the new Ghostbusters movie coming out, we figured now would be a good time to look at a Ghostbusters review. Specifically, CR's review of the Ghostbusters pen and paper RPG.
It's Halloween time.
You sure about that? Okay.
Boys and girls of every age, wouldn't you like to see something strange? Come with us and you will see the Saw Town of Halloween.
This is Halloween, this is Halloween.
Pumpkins, ready for the dead of night.
This is Halloween, everybody make a scene.
Trick or treat, don't think it's gonna be a fight.
Saw Town,
everybody scream. This is Halloween.
I got a better idea.
And here on Cheap Damage, I ain't afraid of no card game, board game, or video game. But there is one thing that just gives me the willies every time I think about it. Pen and paper RPGs. You have all those charts and numbers, but then you also got some guy that just seems to be pulling stuff out of his ass, telling you what to do. It just sends my head reeling. But there was only something that didn't intimidate me right off the bat. Something that presented the components of pen and paper in terms that were both familiar and exciting to me. Something that I could really take to heart.
Something good. Something decent.
Something pure.
Nice segue.
In 1986, a young company named West End Games landed a hot new property to follow up their own in-house role-playing game. 2 years after Ghostbusters premiered, and it was still going strong with adults and kids alike. There were already two animated series trying to capitalize on the popularity.
Only one of which is actually connected to this Ghostbusters.
And how appropriate that even after all these years, it would be Ghostbusters that helps me overcome my fear.
For little children, it seems to have it gives them confidence right at the age when they're most afraid of the supernatural.
Now that's how you know you have something special, when it makes such a good impact like that.
The premise of this game is the premise of the 2009 cross-platform video game. The Ghostbusters are looking to franchise, and you and your friends are the new perspective.
Well, actually, you'd be more accurate in saying this picks up right after the ending of the video game.
Like most RPGs, it all starts with character creation. Now, I may not know much, but I do know that in most cases, you actually start by rolling your stats. Which means that there's always a chance you'll end up with a character that can barely walk and chew gum at the same time.
I've never had to play a game where I had to roll my stats. Then again, I'm not exactly a seasoned veteran, so what the hell do I know?
You start out with 12 skill points, which can be put into 4 categories.
I must say, that is a very nice design for the character sheet.
The first one is brains. How smart your Ghostbuster is. Then there's muscles. How strong you are. Next is moves. Kinda skills for skills' sake. And finally, cool.
What?
No, really, cool. That's kinda your mental stamina. The higher this number is, the harder it is for a spook to scare you. But it also helps in situations where you need to be charismatic or cunning, like bluffing or fast-talking.
Oh, so it's basically charisma, okay. From here, CR explains that how many points you have in a given category determines how many rolls of a traditional six-sided die you get in order to try to get a high enough number to complete an action, using a very good example.
And it's right here that I can see the clear advantage of the D20 system. It has special dice that can be used for all sorts of specific needs and measurements, like the 20-sided die, the 12-sided die, and the initially baffling 4-sided die.
Prepare for one of my favorite rants ever.
What are you? None of your sides are pointing up. You get different numbers on each of them, and they're all going in different directions. You should not be.
To be fair, a 4-sided die can be difficult to read depending on how it's designed.
Although they are more common, it can start to be a chore rolling about 7 dice per action. Ah, but with modern computing comes the Ghostbuster Roller, a simple random number generator program that simulates rolling up to 10 dice, which should do fine for those starting out with the game. Look, it even tells you if you roll the ghost.
Because somebody thought it necessary to create a computer program for a roughly 30-year-old game that almost nobody plays.
Me.
Now let's talk about brownie points. How to describe them? Remember how in some video games when you use special attacks it depletes your health?
No, I've heard of games where you can only use your special when you're low on health.
Well, I hope you're a fan of those. Yes, brownie points is the health system. Every time you take damage from something, you lose some brownie points. But it's also a system that can give you a little extra help. At the start of the game, each player gets 20 brownie points. You can add one die per point to any action. And it's here that I recognize that the damage and health system has a major flaw. Characters can't die. Well, the game specifically says that even if you run out of health, your character is just in the hospital for a couple campaigns. This might sound great for those who don't feel like losing a character they worked so hard on to a dumb mistake, which is what happens when you die in, say, D&D, but it really removes the jeopardy of lasting consequences.
Well, you still have the jeopardy of failing the campaign if everyone gets knocked out.
Especially when you're allowed to give up 1 point from any of your traits and convert that to 20 brownie points right before you die. And what do you have to gain? Well, more brownie points, really. Depending on the outcome of a campaign or investigation, the Ghostmaster will reward you with points if you do a good job. But if you completely botch the mission by, let's say, letting the ghost get away, completely destroying the vicinity in the process, and accidentally tackling a nun...
I don't know how that would happen, but I'm sure it's possible.
All the Ghostmaster can do is replenish half the brownie points you use during the mission. But if you collect enough points, you can trade 30 of them in to add 1 plus dice roll to any of your trades. That's the game's version of leveling up. So in conclusion, brownie points are like MP, HP, and experience all rolled into one.
I actually find that very interesting because it requires you to plan ahead and decide how you want to use your points.
You can also earn extra brownie points each mission by fulfilling your goals. Like a talent, during character creation, you could choose one of 5 goals, like wealth. You have other goals like science, fame, and sex. You know, for... Well, actually, I don't think they could have guessed that the franchise would have been so big with kids. But still, this was written just as the cartoon premiered, and this game actually encourages you to have a string of lovers.
Given Peter's character, that actually makes sense.
One last thing involving stats, though. A Ghostbuster can hold up to 3 pieces of equipment without being hindered. Rule of thumb says that 2 of these items should always be a proton pack and an empty ghost trap.
So, basically, you can only carry 1 item without being hindered.
But there are tons of other equipment, such as ghost detection, spiritual reference guides, environment equipment, and even safety precautions. Your character can carry as many items as their muscle, but if the number of the items is over 4, then the only action they can do is walk.
Then what's the point of being able to carry as many items as your muscle? Unless you're okay with spending the entire campaign as a team pack mule!
Luckily, you can store as much equipment in the Ecto-1 as you like, so you can actually have all the equipment on site. You can even get yourself a cellular phone. That's right, a phone that sits right in your car. Make a call wherever you can fit 2 tons of metal. Only $300 a month.
Oh my god, what a great deal!
Remember how I said you should be frugal with your points? Well, I suppose if you wanted to, you can just take a big old brownie dump and try to supercharge your attack. Could work to your advantage, in theory.
Well, yeah, but your luck would have to be unbelievably shit in order for that not to work.
Once a ghost's ecto-presence is 0, then you can guide him into the trap. Unfortunately, the rules say that you need at least 2 Ghostbusters to wrangle a ghost into a trap, which I think is bullcrap. The Ghostbusters caught ghosts all the time solo. Heck, sometimes they didn't even use proton beams.
Well, you gotta make sure the team sticks together somehow.
Finally, let's talk worst case scenario. If 2 or more Ghostbusters are going full stream on some ugly Mother Hubbard, there's always a chance that they could cross the streams. And if that happens, well, it's pretty much mission over. But in order for that to happen, all parties need to fail the attempt to hit the ghost, and all have to roll a ghost die.
So, in order for that to happen, everyone has to fail miserably.
At that point, it's up to the Ghostmaster to decide whether or not this results in a total protonic reversal. Of course, I don't see why the book phrases it this way. Apparently only good things happen when you cross the streams.
Well, yeah, but whenever the Ghostbusters cross the streams, they're only doing it against an Elseworld god. I'm pretty sure that means the rules change.
Okay, now moving on to what these ghosts can actually do. You should know about ectopresence by now. That's a ghost's HP. But ghosts also have a power number. Like a Ghostbuster's trait, This is the number of dice a ghost will use when attempting an action, and all the ghost's powers revolve around it. And there are attacks that pit a ghost's power against a Ghostbuster's specific trait, like terrorize. This is another simple attack. Basically, it attempts to make a Ghostbuster faint. To terrorize, you roll a ghost's power against the Ghostbuster's coolness. Oh, and by the way, this attack targets everyone within eyesight of the ghost. So it has the potential for a TPK, or total party kill.
Ooh, I'm getting all fancy with the lingo. Am I cool yet?
If you have to ask, the answer is no.
But then there are some attacks that just seem really unbalanced, graded on a scale that is completely left up to the game runner. The book only gives you a vague interpretation of what counts as easy or difficult, even an attack called Murphy's Law. For those who don't know, Murphy's Law is basically the idea that anything that can go wrong will go wrong.
Yeah, I've been dealing with this Murphy a lot lately. Damn it!
I guess it's the ghost's ability to cause misfortune or bad luck. You can have a Ghostbuster lose his pants, make an elevator stop, blow up a gas tank, or even cause a proton pack to malfunction. Could they have left a blanker check? Oh, and of course, most of the time, ghosts will try to run away and hide when confronted with a Ghostbuster, or if they're losing. But is there any solid way of determining if a ghost gets away that is not completely left up to the discretion of the Ghostmaster?
No.
Yeah, I can't imagine that being a pretty big problem. After all, there are DMs who will pull this shit even when there are rules against it. So giving them free rein would be a pretty big negative.
While we're at it, let's talk about a few other clear flaws that I have a hunch kept this game from becoming more popular. The fact that you need two Ghostbusters to operate a trap. No one is in any real danger of dying.
Those really are subjective problems, though.
But speaking of which, a few of these scenarios are a little... well... the follow-up expansion was Hot Rod of the Gods, featuring interdimensional alien greasers with technologically advanced hot rods.
What the fuck does that have to do with ghosts?
Of course, if you don't believe me, you can just check the game out for yourself. I found the complete players and game runners manual, as well as all the expansions on fan websites like Ghostbuster Fans and Ghostbusters International.
Oh, don't look at me like that.
The books are completely out of print, and West End Publishing died years ago. There's no one around nowadays that even cares.
Sheesh, it's just an old, not even that good RPG. Not like I'm grave robbing or anything.
The fuck was that?! Overall, this is a really good video. CR manages to explain everything about the game, including how to play, and what he likes and dislikes about it, without getting repetitive. I also like the use of the artwork to help the viewer visualize what he's talking about. In fact, I'd say if you're looking to get your friends to try out the Ghostbusters RPG, this would make a great and entertaining tutorial video for it. I'm the Review Reviewer. You review it, I review you. Couldn't find enough interesting videos to talk about. Not unless you've got an idea. Summerween.